Good morning. Welcome to Union Baptist Church. It's good to see all of you this morning. I'm asked you to stand for praise and worship as we go to the Lord in prayer. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this day you've blessed us with, Lord. We just thank you for this opportunity. We get to come into your house this morning, Lord, and just worship you, Lord. And we just ask that your Holy Spirit would just flow through us this morning, Lord, up and down each and every aisle, Lord, and just touch hearts and change lives, Lord, that you would just hide us behind the cross up here this morning, Lord, that everyone would just see you and just hear from you this morning, Lord. We just love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
I love you forever, I'll stand.
give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart.
Great are As we continue to worship this morning, we invite our youngest of guests, if they're second grade or under, as long as they're potty trained, we invite them to join our folks in Children's Church.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, in darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God, sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. My Savior God, to Thee. Won't you sing with me how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. Be seated.
Hey, good morning, everyone. I invite you, if you would, please take your copy of God's Word and turn to the book of Daniel, chapter 9. And as you noticed, there was a bit of a theme in the songs we were singing this morning, talking about the greatness of our God. How great is our God? And Daniel understands how great God is, but we're going to see in this passage of Scripture how even Daniel's comprehension, even Daniel's grasp of how great God truly is was going to be broadened by what it is that he's about to see in Daniel chapter 9. And normally I give us a long introduction and explain some back history and all of those things before we really jump into the message. But this morning, we're just going to go ahead and jump right in. So hopefully you found your spot there, Daniel chapter 9. We are continuing this study, this series of living in Babylon, and as you'll recall, this last part, the second half of the book of Daniel, deals with some prophecies that Daniel is given by God to the people of Israel to tell them about some things that are going to be happening with them toward the last days, toward the end times, as God prepares to bring all of time to a close and to if you will, tie up some loose ends that people of Israel have been waiting for so many years. And we're going to follow this same outline that we've been following the past couple of weeks. We're going to look at the vision, then we're going to look at the interpretation of that vision, and then we're going to look at that application, what it means to us, why we need to know what this chapter is telling us. So let's look at the vision first and set the scene. And this is going to be in verses 1 through 3. So read along with me, Daniel chapter 9, verses 1 through 3. In the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, a Mede by birth, who was ruler over the kingdom of the Chaldeans. In the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, and we talked about that last week, how Daniel is just so amazed that God would share these visions, he would share these words with him. And it says, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood from the books, according to the word of the Lord to Jeremiah the prophet, that the number of years for the desolation of Jerusalem would be 70. So when we talk about this desolation, he's talking about this time while the Jewish people have been carried away into exile into the Babylonian kingdom, which now is overtaken by the Medo-Persian Empire. And so he's talking about this time when they are no longer in their city, in their country, and able to worship God in their temple. And so that's what he's talking about here when he talks about these 70 years. And then in verse 3 it says, so I turned my attention to the Lord God to seek him by prayer and petitions with fasting, sackcloth, and ashes. So we recall here that Daniel has now served under three different kings. He served under Nebuchadnezzar first, then Belshazzar, which was one of the descendants of Nebuchadnezzar, and now he's serving under the Medo-Persian leader, who is, depending on which title you go by, either called Cyrus or Darius. And so he served there under these three kings, and he's served in that capacity since he was a teenager. He was carried away, he and his friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, were carried away into captivity around 606 BC. And this Babylonian Empire was defeated. Remember, we saw when the king saw the handwriting, Belshazzar saw the hand or the fingers, better yet, that were writing on the wall, and Daniel interpreted this writing and told Belshazzar that his kingdom that very night would be taken from him. And so that's when the Medo-Persian Empire came in. And we know from history that that happened in 539 BC. And so when we look at that, we understand that Daniel has been in captivity now for at least 67 years. At least 67 years. Most people think that it's closer to 69 years by this particular time. And so Daniel is probably about 80 years old at this time. And he has both been faithful to those kings and faithful to serving God. And you and I, when we look at the book of Daniel, what I've hoped and what I've prayed and what I've worked toward trying to get us to see is that even though we live in an ungodly world, even though we live in an ungodly society and culture, we can be faithful to do the things that God has called us to do and still living under the authorities that God has placed over us. But even while doing that, we can still be faithful to God. Now, I'm not telling you it's easy. I'm not telling you that it's going to be the natural course of action. I'm not telling you that every day is going to be a bed of roses and sunshine. But I am going to tell you that it is possible. And Daniel is a perfect example of living both faithfully to those kings that he has served, living in his society, and also being faithful to God and being obedient to everything that he has told him to do. And he has done this into his 80s. Another interesting thing that I want us to gather very quickly from these three passages is, if you look in verse 2, it says, "I understood from the books according to the word of the Lord to Jeremiah the prophet." Now, when I read that, what that's telling me is that Daniel's been studying the word of God. He's been studying. He's not just been looking into it very casually. He's not just reading by it and saying, "Oh, well, I've gotten my morning devotion done. I can go on about my day and I can do everything else." This tells me that he has been studying the Word of God. He's been digging into the Word of God. And there's something very particular that has caught his attention from the book of Jeremiah. He's been reading in the book of Jeremiah, and he's thinking about his circumstances. He's thinking about the world around him, and he's gathering from God knowledge about what it is that's going on in his day and time and how it is that he's supposed to respond to that. And so he's been paying particular attention to Jeremiah, and he remembers the prophecies that were made by Jeremiah that was called the weeping prophet. You know why Jeremiah was called the weeping prophet? It was because Jeremiah had nothing but bad news to share. Jeremiah was the prophet that was telling the people all of the time, if you don't turn from your sins, God is going to carry us out of the land. God is going to carry us away. He was sharing this bad news, and no matter how hard Jeremiah preached, no matter how often he preached, no matter how passionate he preached this message of we got to turn away from our sins or God's going to carry us out of our land, no matter how much he preached, not a single person was converted under the ministry of Jeremiah. 40 years he preached, and to the best of our knowledge, no one turned away from their wicked ways and called out to God. And so Daniel is reading and he's studying this prophet Jeremiah, this weeping prophet. And certainly he would come across this passage in Jeremiah 25, verses 11 and 12. It says, "This whole land will become a desolate ruin, and these nations will serve the king of Babylon for 70 years. Now that's pretty specific, isn't it? And don't worry, it gets more specific the farther we go. And then in Jeremiah 29, verses 10 and 11 says, "For this is what the Lord says, when 70 years for Babylon are complete, I will attend to you and will confirm my promise concerning you to restore you to this place. For I know the plan, and this is the part of the passage that we know well. We know this, Jeremiah 29:11. We know this one very well, but most of the time we take it out of context. He's talking about the nation of Israel specifically, and he's talking about the plans that he has for them over the grand scheme of human history and over all time. He's talking about this plan, and so he says, "For I know the plans I have for you." This is the Lord's declaration. Plans for your welfare, not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope. And so Daniel, as he's reading this passage of Scripture, and he's studying in Jeremiah how God says that you're going to go into desolation, you're going to go into exile, you're going to be taken from your land, the temple is going to be destroyed, the city is going to lay in ruins, and Daniel is heartbroken over it because Daniel has seen it happen. He's seen the destruction of Jerusalem. He's seen the desolation that has taken place, and it breaks his heart. But then when he gets to that last part and he says, oh, but don't worry, it's got an end to it. He said, God says to his people, Israel, he says, I know what plans I have for you. God says, not only has he read the end of the story, he wrote the end of the story. And he says, I know what the end plans are. I know what plans I have for you. And your ultimate end, your destruction is not going to be final. What I have in store for you is not to ruin you, not to devastate you, but to restore you. He says, I have a future for you. And it's not just a future, it is a hopeful future. And so Daniel hears that, and he latches on to that, and he holds to that promise with everything in his power. See, Daniel understands that God's timing to bring Israel back into its land is coming close. See, how long has Daniel been in exile? How long do we say that he'd been in Babylon? At least 67 years. Most scholars say closer to 69 at this point. And Daniel reads that passage, and he sees where Jeremiah says, the nations will serve the king of Babylon for 70 years. And Daniel's doing the calculation, he's doing the math in his head. He's like, oh my goodness, we're close. We're close to when this promise from God is coming true according to what I understand from the book of Jeremiah. And he says, it's coming close, it's approaching quickly, and he's getting excited, but at the same time, he's got some concerns on his heart. He's got some questions in his mind, because see, he knows that it's going to be 70 years, but he doesn't know exactly when that 70 years began. Because get this, there were three different times that the people of Israel were carried forcibly out of their homeland. Three different times that they were carried into exile. These three different deportations, if you will. In 606 BC, this is when Daniel and his three friends are carried into Babylon. That's the first of these exiles. And so things would be going well, and relationships between Jerusalem and Babylon would be getting better. And then all of a sudden something would happen, and something would change that status quo in that relationship. And the king of Babylon would get upset, and he'd send somebody else into Jerusalem. And they'd go back in, and they'd bring more destruction, and they would take more people out of Jerusalem and carry them back to Babylon. And then in 597, there's the second exile. And during this exile is when the prophet Ezekiel, who also has some prophecies that are given to him by God about end time things. And so he is carried out into this second exile to Babylon. And then finally in 586, there's the third and final of this group of exiles, these forced deportations. And at this point, there's only a handful of Jews that are actually left in Israel. The majority of them are Babylonians that have come in and began to settle, looking for a new place to live, looking for new prosperity. And so there's these foreign people living in the land of Jerusalem at this time, and there's only a few of the Jews that are left. And see, Daniel's issue was, well, do I start my calculations for 70 years? Do I start them at 606 B.C.? Or do I start them at 597 B.C.? Do I start them at 586 B.C.? When do I start this calculation? But he also, in his thinking and his pondering and his meditation on this book of Jeremiah and what his writings are saying, he also remembers that passage in Jeremiah 29. You know, we read the 10 and 11 where it talks about the plans that are made for you. But Daniel keeps on reading. He doesn't take it out of context. He doesn't just stop with that one verse and that says something that he likes and closes the book there. He reads on down. And if you continue reading in Jeremiah 29, verses 12 through 14 says this. It says, "You will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you." This is God speaking to his children of Israel. "You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart." It says, "I will be found by you." This is the Lord's declaration. God said that same thing. He made that same statement when he said, "I know the plans that I have for you. I have a future and a hope for you." That was the same statement he made in there. He says, this is the Lord's declaration, which means it is true. It is unchangeable. There is nothing that can undo this statement. And so he says, this is the Lord's declaration. And he finishes in verse 14. It says, "I will restore you to the place that I deported you from." He says, "I will restore your fortunes and gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you." And then again, he says, this is the Lord's declaration. "I will restore you to the place I deported you from." And so Daniel knows that this restoration is coming. He doesn't know when, but he now also knows what he must do. He must do exactly what God said. He says, "If you will call to me, if you will cry out to me, if you will pray to me, if you will seek me with all of your heart, you will find me." And so this drives Daniel to call out to the Lord. And we hear this prayer in verses 4 through 16. Follow along and read that with me as well. It says, "I prayed to the Lord my God and confessed." Notice that second word there? It doesn't say that he just prayed. He says, "I prayed to the Lord my God and confessed." He says, "Ah, Lord, the great and awe-inspiring God who keeps his gracious covenant with those who love him and keep his commandments. We have sinned. We have done wrong and acted wickedly, rebelled and turned away from your commands and ordinances. We have not listened to your servants, the prophets, who spoke in your name to our kings, leaders, fathers, and all the people of the land. Lord, righteousness belongs to you, but this day public shame belongs to us, the men of Judah, the residents of Jerusalem, and all Israel, those who are near and those who are far, in all the countries where you have dispersed them because of the disloyalty they have shown towards you." See, Daniel is acknowledging something here. He's acknowledging and he's proclaiming the reason why they're in exile is their own fault, because they have turned away from God, because they have stopped listening and obeying his word and his ordinances. Verse 8, "Lord, public shame belongs to us, our kings, our leaders, and our fathers, because we have sinned against you. Compassion and forgiveness belong to the Lord our God, though we have rebelled against him and have not obeyed the voice of the Lord our God by following his instructions that he set before us through his servants, the prophets. All Israel has broken your law and turned away, refused to obey you. The promised curse," and we'll talk about that again in just a second, "the promised curse written down in the law of Moses, the servant of God, has been poured out on us because we have sinned against him. He has carried out his words that he spoke against us and against our rulers by bringing on us so great a disaster that nothing like what has been done to Jerusalem has ever been done under all of heaven. Just as it is written in the law of Moses, all this disaster has come on us. Yet we have not appeased the Lord our God by turning from our iniquities." There's been no repentance. There's been no turning back to God. Yet we have not appeased the Lord our God by turning from our iniquities and paying attention to your truth. So the Lord kept the disaster in mind and brought it on us. For the Lord our God is righteous in all that he has done, but we have not obeyed him." How's that for a prayer from a prophet who knows that a joyous day is coming. See, I don't know about you, but when I think about what I would be praying here, or what I would be thinking, is I would be thinking, God, it's time. Let's rejoice. Let's celebrate. Let's start a party. The end of this destruction, the end of this desolation has come. It's time for us to gather together. You're going to send us back to our homeland. But that's not Daniel's attitude. That's not his concern. See, Daniel, it says that he went to God and he confessed those sins. Now, I know that we like to focus on the numbers and the vision itself in this chapter, and we're gonna get to that, and we're going to read that vision, and we're going to talk a little bit about the numbers and things that means. But I want to tell you, we should never overlook what Daniel is saying in his prayer. Because Daniel's prayer is far more important to us than what God revealed to him about numbers and the end of times and how to calculate those things. Because what Daniel is going to talk about in those numbers and those events and those things that are going to take place, those are temporary events. But if we gain and we latch on to what Daniel is trying to teach us in his prayer, that will last us for an eternity. So let's look at Daniel's prayer. In this prayer, the first thing that Daniel begins to do is he starts to compare God to the people. And I'm going to tell you, any time you begin to compare people to God, you're going to find a drastic contrast in those two things. Because see, here's some of the ways that Daniel describes God here. He said that God is a great and awe-inspiring God. Says that he keeps his covenants. And those covenants that he keeps, when he makes those promises, when he makes those agreements with his people, those covenants are gracious. It demonstrates his mercy towards us. Even when he makes a deal with us, and when he makes a pact or a promise with us, it's demonstrations of his compassion and his graciousness. And then Daniel says that he is righteous. And Daniel, by the way, he goes all the way to saying that God is righteous no matter what he does. Even when he brings judgment, God is righteous in all of his dealings. And then he reminds us again, because he's about to call upon these things, but he reminds us again that God is a compassionate God and a forgiving God. That even in his justice, God still has compassion. He still offers forgiveness. And then the last thing he says about him is that he is always faithful to keep his promises. So when you find a covenant, when you find an agreement in the Word of God between God and his people, whether it's between God and the people of Israel at the time, or whether it's between God and the New Testament church, whenever God makes a covenant or a promise with his people, we always know, even when we fail, God is going to keep that promise. But listen to the way that Daniel describes the people in contrast to God. He says, we have sinned, done wrong, acted wickedly, rebelled, and turned away. You know, I don't know how many ways there are to describe the ways that we've messed up. But Daniel just tips the iceberg of the list. You know, he gives us all of these different words that describe the ways that we mess up, but there it's not even close to being able to describe the ways that we've messed up. And you might be saying, somebody might be out there sitting and thinking, oh, well, that's me. He's describing me. He's talking about me. I've messed up in so many different ways. I understand that. I relate to you. I've done the same thing. But let me give you a warning to the person who's sitting out there and is sitting there surrounded and clothed in their self-righteousness saying, oh, well, I'm glad that he's not talking about me. Let me remind you when Jesus described someone who was going into the temple and praying, and they prayed, Lord, I thank you that I'm not like this person, or I thank you that I'm not like that person. And it describes how Jesus said that this person would have no part in his kingdom. Every single one of us. The Bible says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Meaning that standard, that level of perfection that God sets for us. See, God is the standard. His perfection is the standard. And there's not a single one of us that meets that standard. And so there are none righteous. And so he says, we have all sinned. We've done wrong. We've acted wickedly. We've rebelled. And we've turned away from God. And all of the other ways that we can describe the things that we do to mess up. And then he says, and despite that, you've given us messages. You've given us words where you've tried to call us back to repentance. And we will not listen to you. We haven't heard the prophets. We haven't heard the visions and the dreams that you've given. We haven't heard any of the ways that God has tried to speak to his people. We have not listened to those messages. And he says that includes the kings, the leaders, the fathers, and all of the people of the land. And because we won't listen to your message, because we won't listen to your call to repentance, we stand in public shame. Those are the words that he used to describe Israel. Public shame. He says we're in captivity. We've been snatched out of our own land. We've been taken from our homes. Our homes have been destroyed. But even worse than that, we're far away from the place where we can go and we can worship God. And that place has even been destroyed. He says we're in public shame. It doesn't matter whether it's those that are still there in Jerusalem. It doesn't matter whether it's those here in Babylon. And it doesn't matter whether it's any of those people of the Jewish nation that have been scattered to all of the places of the world where the Lord has sent them. All of us have broken your law. And he says then that there's a promised curse that was given in the law of Moses. And basically Daniel is crying out to God and he's saying, God, I know we've broken your law. Every part of it, we've broken your law. Even down to the command that you've given us to honor the Sabbath, we have broken it. Even the laws about letting the land rest on the Sabbath year, that every seventh year, he said, we've dishonored your word. We've not obeyed your commands. We've broken your law. And because we have broken your law, because we have sinned, we deserve your judgment. That's what Daniel says. He says we deserve anything that you dish out to us because we stand defenseless before a perfect God. See, Daniel's not giving an excuse here. He's not saying, well, God, yeah, this, we have broken your laws and we're not keeping your commands and we're not honoring your Sabbaths, but God, it's not our fault. It's those Babylons. Those Babylons came in and took us out of the land, so we can't worship in the temple anymore. It's their fault to strike them, bring them down with your anger. Don't punish us for something that's not our fault. And God's reminding Daniel the whole time, it is your fault. Because see, Babylon was not the reason they were taken out of captivity. Babylon was just the instrument that God used. See, they were long since disobeying God's commands. And all of the prophets are trying, including Jeremiah. We heard just a few minutes ago, Jeremiah was trying to call the people back to God so that this destruction would not happen. But they would not listen. And so Daniel is owning up to the sins of Israel. He's not putting it off on somebody else like we do so many times today. We won't stand up and accept the things that we've done and the mistakes we've made. We always try to blame it on somebody else. But Daniel says, we deserve this. And Daniel says to God, I accept your punishment as just. Whatever you give us is what we deserve. But then God, As Daniel is reminded of God's mercy, Daniel calls out and he pleads for that mercy. Look at verses 17, 18, and 19. He says, therefore, our God, hear the prayer and the petitions of your servant. Show your favor to your desolate sanctuary for the Lord's sake. Listen, my God, hear. Open your eyes and see our desolation and the city called by your name. For we are not presenting our petitions before you based on our righteous acts, but based on your abundant compassion. Lord, hear. Lord, forgive. Lord, listen and act. My God, for your own sake, do not delay, because your city and your people are called by your name. Let me ask you a question. What is it that Daniel is asking God to do here? There's a couple of different things that he's asking. He's asking for God to forgive their sin. He's asking God to take this captivity and return them back to their land. And he's asking God to restore their temple, to restore their worship of Yahweh. This phrase, when they say the Lord our God, he's talking about Yahweh. He's using that term. And he's saying, please restore, forgive our sin, restore us into our land, and restore the worship of Yahweh to the way that you intended. So that's what Daniel is asking for. But I want you to, when you hear this plea, when you hear this prayer, I want you to hear the motivation behind Daniel's plea. He's praying for these things, not for his own sake. He's praying for these things, not even for the sake of the people of Israel. He's crying out for these things, and he's asking to do this because of God's reputation. See, in this day and age, when an army was able to come in and conquer your land, that was, for those people, that was a reflection on the strength and the power of your God. Because they truly believed that when someone went into battle, they would pray to their God and they would bring their idols out to battle with them. And you remember many of the times when Israel would go out to war, they would bring with them the Ark of the Covenant, because they thought that represented the presence of God. And so when peoples would go out into battle, they would take their God with them. And if they prevailed in that battle, they thought that meant that their God was strong. And they thought that meant that their God was more powerful than the God of the other army. And so when they were defeated, when they were conquered, when the temple was destroyed, they knew that the other people around them, the other countries, the other nations, they thought, oh, that Yahweh, there's nothing to that God. Our God's more powerful than him. We were able to conquer them. We've got them as our servants. We've been able to go into their nation three different times and devastate their land and carry their people out. Then our God must be more powerful than their God. And so Daniel cries out to God, and he says, God, for the sake of your reputation, restore us back to our land. Restore our worship. But more importantly, forgive our sin, because I know our sin is what is preventing you from doing what it is that you want to do. And so Daniel cries out and he pleads and he asks for those things because of God's reputation. He uses the phrase over and over again, for the Lord's sake and for your name's sake. He doesn't say for the people of Israel's sake. He doesn't say for your servant Daniel's sake. He says for your name's sake, for the Lord's sake. And then we hear the basis upon which God should grant those pleas. God sent Gabriel to show Daniel that he would restore him. He sent Gabriel. He sent this angel we're going to read about it in just a minute. He sends him to show him that he's going to bring these things about. But Daniel, when he cries out to God, he says, not based upon our righteous acts. You know why Daniel why he said not based upon our righteous acts? You know why he said that? Because they didn't have any. They didn't have any righteous acts. All they had was generations, and I'm not saying singular, I'm plural, generations of abandoning God's law, of dishonoring his Sabbaths, and not honoring the things that God had told them to do. Generations of that. That's all had to bring to God was their disobedience. And so Daniel says, not because of any righteous acts that we've done, but because of your abundant compassion. He's just falling down before God and saying, God, have mercy on us. Because whatever punishment you have for us, that's what we deserve. We don't deserve your mercy. But because of your compassion, you would do. And so Daniel asked God to do what he said he would do. And so God sends Gabriel, as I said earlier, to show Daniel that he would complete this promise, that he would fulfill it. But you know, there's so many times when God answers our prayers, he didn't just give us what we asked for. He gives us even more than that. When our heart truly is turned toward God, when we truly come to him in repentance, God doesn't just give us he doesn't just give us what we ask for, he gives us so much more than that. And so Daniel is asking him to restore us back into the land. Give us the things that you've told us you would, not because of our righteous acts, but because of your compassion. God, take us back to the land. How much longer will it be before we're restored back into our land? And so God gives him that answer through the book of Jeremiah. But then he also gives him more than that through this vision that he's going to see and through this conversation he's going to have with Gabriel the angel. He gives him knowledge about future events that relate to the people of Israel. So let's move now to the interpretation of this vision and look at verses 20 through 27. It says, while I was speaking, while I was praying, confessing my sins and the sins of my people Israel, and presenting my petition before Yahweh my God concerning the holy mountain of God, while I was praying, Gabriel, and in case you were wondering who this was, which Gabriel it was, he says the same one I told you about earlier, same Gabriel I mentioned earlier. The man I had seen in the first vision came to me in my extreme weariness about the time of the evening offering. He gave me this explanation. Daniel, I've come now to give you understanding. At the beginning of your petitions, an answer went out, and I have come to give it, for you are treasured by God. Now, I don't know about you, but that kind of stuck out at me. The way Gabriel described God's view of Daniel. It says that while he was still praying, that Daniel was so precious to God, he was so treasured by God, that as soon as Daniel started praying, God said, okay, hey, Gabriel, come here. You're going to go and answer this prayer. And this wasn't just, Gabriel's not just any old angel. He's one of the higher serving. Because when you think about the angels of heaven, you should think more about an army rather than a little cherub sitting on a cloud with wings on his back like we think of. That's not the picture of an angel that's given from Scripture. You should think of a warrior. You should think of an army. The host of heaven, as the angels are called, are warriors. That's heaven's army. And so God calls Gabriel and he says, I've got this important message for you to carry. I want you to go down to my servant Daniel, the one who is treasured by me. And I want you to give him this message and give him this answer to his prayer. Verse 22, he gave me this explanation. Daniel, I've come now to give you understanding. At the beginning of your petition, an answer went out. And I have come to give it, for you are treasured by God. So consider the message and understand the vision. Now here's the message that Gabriel is delivering to Daniel from God. It says, 70 weeks are decreed about your people and your holy city to bring the rebellion to an end, to put a stop to sin, to wipe away iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness. Now I want to stop right there for just a second. What do you hear when you hear this description of what it says that God is going to do? It says he is going to bring an end to our rebellion. It says that he is going to put a stop to sin. He's going to wipe away iniquity, and he's going to bring everlasting righteousness. That sounds like heaven to me. That's what heaven will be. And it's, more specifically, it's talking about the millennial reign that will take place after Jesus comes, when Jesus comes, someone mentioned that this is describing Jesus and his coming. Yes, when Jesus comes, there's going to be a millennial reign that is set up, and there will be no sin on the earth. There will be no iniquity. Everlasting righteousness. And then Gabriel goes on and he tells Daniel, and to anoint the most holy place. Know and understand this. From the issuing of the decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until Messiah, the prince, will be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. And we're going to talk in just a second about what that actually means. It will be rebuilt with a plaza and a moat, but in difficult times. After those 62 weeks, the Messiah will be cut off and will have nothing. The people of the coming prince will destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end will come with a flood, like a flood. Until the end, there will be war. Desolations are decreed. He will make a firm covenant with many for 1 week, but in the middle of the week, he will put a stop to sacrifice and offering. And the abomination of desolation will be on a wing of the temple until the decreed destruction is poured out on the desolator. All right, so God responds to Daniel's prayer, and the timing of this is, like I said earlier, it's almost immediate. Gabriel says, as soon as you started praying, Daniel, God sent an answer, and he sent it through me. I'm here to deliver this answer because you are treasured by God, because I care enough about you particularly. I've given this message to all of my people, to all of the people of Israel. I've chosen you to deliver this message to at this particular time. And he said, and here's this message. You've asked about the 70 years, and yes, that's going to take place, and that's going to come to an end, and I'll send the people back into Israel. He says, but I want to tell you about something greater than that. I want to tell you about something that spans greater time than that. I want to tell you about how the nation of Israel will be carried out and will be monitored by God and protected by God and escorted through time by God as the people of God, and how that's going to come to an end, and how all of this is going to be restored. He said there's going to be a period of 77s. If you go back to the original language, that's what it says, 77s. And so interpreters have changed that 77s to mean 70 weeks, because there's 7 days in a week. But most scholars that are very conservative, they agree when he says 70 weeks, he's not talking about weeks, he's talking about weeks of years. And so if you take that 70 times 7 and multiply that together, he's talking about a total of 490 years until Israel is going to be restored to the prophecy fulfilled, where God is going to bring total restoration back to Israel, and his son, the king, the prince, the Messiah, will sit on the throne in Jerusalem. So there's a total of 490 years here. But these set of 77s, or these 490 years, they're divided into groups. They're divided into sets of sevens. And so 7 weeks are 49 years. That first one, it says 1 week to begin with. It says that first week, this is Artaxerxes ordered, when he ordered to rebuild the city of Jerusalem. And from the time that he gave that order to rebuild it, there are 49 years that pass until the city is actually rebuilt. And so that's that first week that he's talking about. Then he says that there's 62 weeks, or 434 years. From the time that order is given, you travel through time and you go 434 years and you get to, and I don't have the time in this message to go through all of the prophecies and the calculations, but if you go 434 years into the future, down to the very day, using a 360-day calendar, which is what the Jewish people used, and what, when you talk about years in the Bible, it's using, but to the day from that declaration is when Jesus enters into Jerusalem on what we call his triumphal entry. When people are bowing down before him, declaring him the king and calling him the Messiah, singing Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest, and they're laying palm branches and clothing down before him, they're declaring him their king. And so down to the day this happens. And you're thinking, well, wait a minute, 40, you're doing some quick math in your head. 49 plus 434 is not 490. There's seven more years that are left. And see, what the Old Testament prophets did not understand, and we have the rest of the Bible and the New Testament to tell us about these things, and we have other prophecies like those in Revelation and those in Ezekiel that come. But they didn't understand that between this 83rd year, and the 490th year, there's going to be a gap. That gap is the church period. That gap is from the time when Jesus went to the cross, when he took all of mankind's sin upon himself, and he defeated it on the cross when he died, and he went into the grave, and he defeated death, hell, and the grave, and then he arose victoriously, and he ushered in and he began what we call the church age. And there's that gap there, and we're living now in this gap. There is going to come a time, and I don't believe it's very far, but there is going to come a time when Jesus, it's almost like God was looking at the timeline, and he's looking at his people of Israel, and it gets to the cross, and it gets to Jesus Christ, and God, he hits a pause button on Israel. And see, he's no longer fulfilling those prophecies right now about Israel. He's put the pause button on them, and now he's dealing with the church, and he's called the Gentile nations. He's called the people from all nations of the world, and he's calling them in to be grafted into the family of Abraham through faith, and he's making them a part of Israel. And then when that time comes to a fulfillment, when he's done that and he's satisfied that everyone who will turn to him has turned to him, he's going to go back to Israel, and he's going to hit that play button again, and he's going to pick back up, and he's going to go into those last 7 years that are talked about. He's going to go into what we call the Great Tribulation, or the Tribulation and then the Great Tribulation. And we'll pick up more information about that, because I know I can see it on your faces, a whole lots of questions that just popped up. Like, what in the world is he talking about? We'll pick that up in next message, because we're either I've got to preach faster or y'all got to listen faster one. We come to the application of this vision. Now, I told you earlier that God gave Daniel this vision. He talked a lot about these numbers. He talked about these fulfillment. He talked about this bringing to an end, the end of time. But I also told you that shouldn't be the important part for us. Our attention should be on Daniel's prayer, not his vision. And so we need to go back to look at Daniel and see what his attitude was when he went to prayer, when he cried out to God. So I want you to go back to chapter 9, verse 3. Daniel said, "So I turned my attention to the Lord God to seek him by prayer and petition with fasting and sackcloth and ashes." First thing I want to draw your attention to there as we see this application for us is the fact that he turned his attention to God. He turned his attention to God. When I think about the way that we live our lives in this day and age, I think about how we're on such a fast pace. We're constantly running. We're constantly striving. We're constantly working and working and working. And for many of us, our goal is, oh, I got to work. So I can get to the weekend so I can relax. But then you get to the weekend, and then there's all these things you got to do on the weekend, whether it's things around the house that need to be done, or whether it's activities with the kids. We got to go this place, we got to go that place, and we our attention is just there's so many things that are grappling for our attention as human beings that we don't know where to look. I mean, we're looking in all these different directions, trying to find satisfaction. We're trying to find fulfillment. And what we don't understand is no matter what those things are, they're not going to provide that satisfaction. They're not going to provide that fulfillment. Because God did not design humans to be fulfilled with more money. God didn't design human beings to be fulfilled by more activity. He didn't design us to be fulfilled by more stuff. You know, and he didn't even design us to be fulfilled by more relaxation and more downtime and all those things that we seem to be chasing. But this world is clamoring for our attention, and God says, I've designed you for one purpose. I've designed you in such a way that the only thing that's going to bring you satisfaction, the only thing that's going to bring you fulfillment, is turning to God and worshiping God. That's how he designed us. I heard a preacher describe it one time, one way, as God has created within man a God-shaped hole. And you ever played those little toddler games? Yeah, again, I told y'all, your pastor, his mind just works differently. But you remember those little games that you would buy for your toddlers, and you got these little different pieces, and they all have different shapes, and then there's this board, this box that you got to put them in, and you pick up one, and you look at the shape, and there's only one that's supposed to fit that shape, and you have to put it in that one in order for it to get it in. See, when God made humans, he made us with a void within us that is only filled by God himself. It doesn't matter how many times we try to cram working harder and working 7 days a week into that hole, it ain't gonna fill it. It don't matter how many times we try to seek power, we try to seek authority, and we try to lord ourselves over men, and we try to cram it into that hole, it ain't gonna fit. It doesn't matter how many times we look for pleasure, carnal pleasure in the things of this world. It doesn't matter how many times we try to cram it into that hole, it's just not going to fit. The only thing that fits there and the only thing that fills that hole is worshiping God. And the sooner we figure that out, the better off we'll be. And so Daniel, it says that he turned his attention to the Lord. And truth is, he's the only one that can fulfill our greatest needs anyway. And when he turned his attention to the Lord, the next thing it says is that he went to the Lord in prayer and petitions. One thing I noticed this scripture did not say is he didn't turn to the latest self-help book to fix his problems. He didn't turn to the latest medication that comes out to fulfill his problems. He didn't turn to the latest psychological theories to fulfill his problems. It says he turned to the Lord in prayer and petition. He didn't even turn to his own righteousness because he knew he didn't have any. It says he sought forgiveness from the Lord. When he went to God and he prayed, he didn't pray for more money. He didn't pray for peace between his people and the Medo-Persian Empire. He didn't pray for that. He didn't pray, God, just give us all the things that we want. So many times we go to God and we go to him and we pray. What we do is, and I heard John MacArthur say, we go to God like he's a glorified Santa Claus. We go to him with our list of requests. We've gone through the Sears catalog and we've made our list of things that we want for Christmas. And some of you younger folks, you know, have no idea what I'm talking about when I say Sears catalog. Some of you do. For you folks, it's they went through Amazon and scrolled through Amazon and made their shopping list for Santa Claus. So many times we go to God like he's a glorified Santa Claus, and we have all these things, these wants and wishes that we bring to him. But that's not what Daniel did. Daniel went to him and said, we have sinned against you. We have done wrong. We have been wicked before you. Forgive us of our sins. And that's what he goes to him and he asks for. And Daniel understands that he is the only source of forgiveness that there is. And Daniel also understands that he needs that forgiveness before he can ever even dare ask for anything else. And it says the way he went to him in prayer is that he went to him with fasting in sackcloth and ashes. And I'm bringing it to a close here, but I want you to know that when Daniel talks about fasting in sackcloth and ashes, these are very significant symbols in the Jewish culture. These are symbols of mourning. These are things that the Jewish people did when they were heartbroken, when they had lost someone dear to them, when something terrible had happened in their life. They would go to God and they would sit in ashes and pour ashes upon their head, and they would put sackcloth on them instead of comfortable, normal clothes. They would go to Him in mourning because they were brokenhearted over whatever had happened. And so Daniel says that he went to God in suffering, in sackcloth and ashes, and he fasted because of this. See, Daniel seen the damage and destruction that the sins of his people had brought. And he was brokenhearted over all this that had happened. And it led him to mourn as he went to God to ask for relief. Let me ask you this. I wonder if we as a people, and I mean this as Christians, people that are part of the church, people that proclaim to follow Jesus Christ, I wonder, are we really heartbroken over our sin? Does it really cause us to mourn? Because you know, when I look at our country and I look at our nation, I look at the people around us, I don't see heartbrokenness. I see people that are reveling in their sin. I see people that are celebrating their sin. And you might be thinking, well, wait a minute, preacher. No, you're talking about the lost people. You're talking about the ones that are outside of the church. No, I'm talking about people within the church. I'm talking about us as a whole and as individuals. When's the last time you looked at the world around you and you were heartbroken over the sin? When's the last time you looked at your personal sin and were broken because you realized you were breaking the heart of God? When's the last time you cared enough about it to fast over it, to mourn? And I want to close with this from Scripture. And then we'll have our musicians come and lead us in a song of invitation. But I want to share this scripture with you. This is our hope. This is our promise from God. He says in 2 Chronicles, you've heard it plenty of times before, but maybe you've never made it personal. 2 Chronicles 7:14. He says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, pray, and seek my face and turn from their evil ways, then I will hear from heaven. I will forgive their sins and I will heal their land. When's the last time you personally fell on your face before God and wept because of the sin that we as the people of God had allowed into our life? When's the last time you fell on your face and wept because of the sin in your life and you've gone to God and you've asked for that forgiveness? When's the last time you've mourned over sinfulness? Maybe God's bringing you to that point today. And I encourage you, if He has, to come and kneel down at this altar, fall down before God, confess your sinfulness, pray for forgiveness, but ask God to be glorified in your life. Maybe you're here today and you've never done that. Maybe you don't even know what a relationship with Jesus Christ is. But you've realized today from the Word of God that you have sin in your life. And that sin brings destruction and it brings everlasting separation from God. And that's not what you want. And you realize that you want to fall down before God and you want to ask for that forgiveness and you want to receive eternal life. I want you to know you can do that right now as well. You can come, you can kneel down at the altar, you can go to God and pray. If there's anything I can do to help you, I'd be happy to pray with you. But whatever that is, bring that need to God. Bring that brokenheartedness to Him. Maybe you're brokenhearted for a lost loved one or coworker or a fellow student at school. Maybe God's placing them on your heart. Come now, pray for that person, pray for that individual, pray that God will bring them to salvation. Whatever your need is, bring it to God and allow Him to deal with it as we stand and sing together.
Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you.
announcements to share with you guys before we head out. Of course, I want to invite all of you to come back this evening, 6 o'clock. We will be continuing our study of the book of Daniel in our adult classes, and our kids' classes will be going on as normal, so they'll be having classes as well. But we're continuing to study the book of Daniel in our adult small group studies. And if you can't make it on Sunday nights at 6, maybe you're helping with one of those kids' classes or whatever you're doing, you could always come on Monday night at 6 when we do that same lesson. All right, and our next announcement is Brotherhood. It is going to be Thursday, September 19th. And I believe we're going to be doing another job. We're going to be working. Instead of meeting and eating, we're going to meet and work. And we're going to be working on installation of a wheelchair ramp. And that is going to be at 5:30 p.m. Or maybe if you're a little bit later than that getting off work, that's fine. Come along however much time you can. And if you need the address for where we're going to be meeting, see Mr. Kevin. Raise your hand there, Mr. Kevin. See Mr. Kevin. He will get that address to you and make sure you know where to go to come and help out with that. Also on Thursday, we're going to be having our VIP senior lunching, and that's going to be at 11 a.m. Is that correct, Ms. Mona? 11 a.m. here at the church, so make sure you make plans to attend for that. I hear somebody might be cooking some type of bird. Is that correct? They've talked me into coming and cooking a chickabog for you guys, so we look forward to that. Next week, I'm going to announce it so you guys can be putting it on your calendar. The following week, on Tuesday, September 24th, we're going to be having the next installment of our men's Bible study. And we're in the book of James right now and learning some wonderful things and seeing how to apply those things in our life from the viewpoint specifically applying this to men. And so make plans for that. That'll be September 24th, next Tuesday at 6:30. The next announcement is, I know it's a long time off. This is about a men's retreat that's going to be coming up in March. But the reason we're announcing it now is we kind of need to know who wants to attend this. Because one, we've got to make reservations. And two, we have 12 spots that have been allotted to us. And if we need more, we can get more. But if we don't need all 12 of those, then we need to make that decision and free those up for other folks, because it's going to be okay. All right, so he says those 12 spots have been taken. So if you're wanting to go, and I would certainly recommend it, if you can take the time and make the effort and pay the $185 to do this, I would certainly recommend it. Johnny Hunt is one of my favorite preachers to listen to. Delivers a wonderful message, but I just believe that he delivers very timely messages to men, and so I would certainly encourage you to consider that. But if you are considering going, please let Mr. Kevin know so he can ask for how many beds we need for that to be up for our reservations. All right, and is that the last one on the slides? Okay, I got two things that I didn't get to put on the slides and didn't make those. Nursery workers, the new year has actually started, but the new calendar year is going to be coming up pretty soon, and so they're trying to work on scheduling our nursery workers. And so any of you that currently work in the nursery and you plan to continue to work in the nursery, please put your name on that list that's in the foyer on that big piece of furniture there between the two sanctuary doors. Put that on there. Or maybe you feel like the Lord, maybe you're fairly new to the church and the Lord's leading you to get involved, and you're wondering, well, where do I need to get involved? Well, if this is something that interests you and you're willing to help out and serve in that capacity, they would certainly be happy to put you to work helping take care of those babies. And so please sign up on the sheet that's in the foyer if that is something that you feel like God is leading you to do. And then the last announcement that I have written down is we're planning to do our next baptism on October the 20th. And I've got a couple of people that I know are planning to be baptized on that date. But if you would like to be baptized then, maybe you made a profession of faith recently, then please see me. I'd love to be able to sit down and talk with you and talk about your relationship with Christ. And hopefully possibly put you on that list to participate in that baptism service. So that's October the 20th, and please let me know if you're interested in that. All right, and if you're a guest with us today, if you're visiting with us, we would certainly love to hear from you, to be able to make a connection with you. I'd love to be able to send you a text or an email or however it is that you prefer communicating. And so if you would, please fill out one of our visitors cards. Those are also back in the foyer, and you get to them to any of those gentlemen that are in the foyer, and they'll get that to me. Or maybe you've got a need today. You've got a prayer request that's weighing heavy on your heart, and you'd like for me to talk with you or pray with you. Just let me know that. I'll be out in the foyer. Just come grab me, and we'll come over to the room up here in the front, and we'll sit and we'll talk and pray. Whatever it is that you need to deal with, we'll go to the Lord together on that. Any other announcements that I've failed to make, that I've overlooked? All right, well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for today. We thank you for your word that gives us direction, that gives us purpose, that shows us who you are and who we are in light of that. And Lord, it shows us how to relate to you, how to interact with you, and how to worship you. So we thank you for that. But Lord, we thank you that when we study your word, it's like looking into a mirror. It shows us what we're really like. And Lord, it shows us that we need you desperately. And so, Lord, we thank you that you are available. We thank you that when we call on you, you listen. And Lord, we just ask you to continue to work in our lives. Go with us as we seek to serve you and obey you so that you are glorified in everything that we do. And we ask you for that, and we thank you for that. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.